My name is Kevin Carey. I direct the education policy program here at New America. And we are very pleased to have this event focused on the new book by one of our New America fellows, Anya Kamenetz, The Test, Why Our Schools Are Obsessed with Standardized Testing, But You Don't Have to Be. In addition to its various programs, New America has a very robust fellows program. Every year, a lot of fantastic books come out, and we're really pleased that this could be one of them. We're also joined and very happy to have Maurice Sykes with us today, who's the Executive Director of Early Childhood Development at the University of District of Columbia here in Washington, D.C., to also talk about some of these issues. So I know everyone has come here to listen to Anya talk about her book, and so we'll start with that directly. So in reading the book, and I think if this were on Jon Stewart, I would do this, right? The camera would pan in for a moment. I don't know if we can do that out there. So you start your book in the introduction, and I'm going to read from the second paragraph, which says, as an education writer for the past 12 years, and as a parent talking to other parents, I've seen how high-stakes standardized tests are stunting children's spirits, adding stress to family life, demoralizing teachers, undermining schools, paralyzing the education debate, and gutting our country's future competitiveness. So that sounds pretty terrible. We would love to know how you came to those conclusions and what brought you to write this book.
Thank you so much, Kevin, and thank you to the New America Foundation for supporting my work and for hosting me here in this wonderful venue, and also for all of your thought partnership over the years. It's been really great. The reason, you know, that sounds like a damning bill against standardized testing, and I did not set out to write a book about standardized testing. I'd written a previous book, DIYU, which was about innovation and higher education and transformation and technology and economic change and globalization and all these forces moving within the higher ed world. And I wanted to write a very similar book about K-12 education. I had had a child and I was interested in K-12, and I had heard ideas of things that were going on in K-12, in pre-K-12, that I thought were really fascinating about social and emotional learning, about technology use, about homeschooling, unschooling, about various types of uses of connected learning and educators getting connected. And I wrote a proposal about these things, and my agent said, you know, there seems like there's something missing from the center of this. All of these movements, all these ideas are very much at the edges of public education. Why is that? And I said, well, because of standardized testing, changes and updates in education that we are looking for, that we need, public schools don't seem to be able to incorporate those things because of so many resources being pushed towards standardized testing, because of schools being held accountable for standardized tests and the outcomes of standardized tests. And he said, well, you kind of have to write about the gorilla in the room and not just write about, you know, the nice party that's going on. So I said, okay, this is what the book's about. It's about standardized testing. And I didn't know much about it at the time. But through my research, what I really came to realize was that there was a really, really deep, the issue at the heart of this book is sort of America's core moral issue, which is we want to have a broadly open and competitive society with fair level playing ground where people of various backgrounds can come to compete and to succeed based on their merit. We're all in for meritocracy, we're all in for competition, but we want that competition to be fair, and that's kind of America's unique contribution. In order for there to be a fair competition, though, you really need to have fair marking posts. You need to be really, really correct about the information that you're using to judge people against each other. And what I came to kind of see is that standardized tests are not that mark. They've never been that mark. The more we try to make them an instrument of increasing equality, the more they're going to fail us, and the more they're going to fail the kids that really need most of our help and most of our support.
And you know, your book is pretty comprehensive in looking at the full dimension of critiques that have been leveled against standardized tests and the different ways that they can and are can be in our problematic. Can you distinguish among some of those major dimensions? Because I think, you know, partly you talk about the limitations of the tests themselves as instruments of revealing knowledge, but then quite a bit is about the use of them, their implementation for school accountability, for teacher evaluation, student promotion, et cetera, and those seem like important distinctions.
Yeah, that's a really important distinction. Thank you. So. So first, we're going to talk about standardized tests themselves. We're going to say that they're in a tradition of psychometrics and intelligence testing, which dates back to the 19th century, which is based on some pretty foundational social science techniques, but also has always been involved in it with an ideology that is a eugenicist ideology. The people that came up with psychometrics were, by and large, eugenicists. And so there's limitations in the conception of intelligence as a fixed, unitary, hereditary quality. And even when we were migrated over into what is called achievement tests, which are attempting to measure not aptitude, but not math and reading knowledge at a particular point in time, the way that the tests are designed and normed and referenced still bears this lineage that comes from the intelligence tests that came before them. So the tests as instruments have limitations. They are technical limitations of the tests because they are created by companies. You know, they are fallible. There are mistakes in the tests often. That people sort of criticize individual items on the tests, and they're always open to debate. We don't have transparency about the items on the tests, truth in testing laws, and that debate goes back to the 1970s and Ralph Nader talking about we can't really examine test items because they're companies' proprietary information, so there isn't a robust public debate about the value of particular test items. So that's the tests as an instrument. The tests, when you attach high stakes to them, become a totally different animal, because while you can argue, reasonable people can argue about the value of a particular math or reading score, let's say for a teacher doing diagnostics or for a school that wants to beef up its program in one subject or another, once you make and punish, mostly punish, there are some carrots in the No Child Left Behind law, but mostly they're sticks. When you punish schools, punish teachers, and districts and states for the results of these tests, when you attach so many different outcomes to the results of a specific individual test, that's when you really start to have problems. And that's what we're kind of seeing here right now is a kind of a popular revolt against the idea of high stakes testing.
Now, one of the responses that people bring up around the critiques of the quality of tests is, well, that's true, but we're now in the process of moving toward a new set of exams aligned with the Common Core that are going to be put in place for the first time at the end of this school year, so right upon us, the product of $300 million in federal investment.
Right.
You say this is going to make things worse in the book. Why is that?
I mean, one of the ironies of the last few years of federal policy is while, the Obama administration has been pushing for attaching more consequences to the tests, specifically in terms of teacher accountability ratings being tied to test outcomes, at the same time, they've been saying that current tests are not very good and funding this enormous effort for the Common Core and Common Core aligned testing, as you say. I talked to some of the folks working on making those tests, and I talked to people that have independently reviewed them, and what they've basically told me is that there's not a really huge departure in terms of a kind of test with the new Common Core tests. They're more difficult. There's going to be a major score drop in the next few years, and the score drop is why I say that this causes more problems, because more failing schools, more failing students, more panic. If you see the recent case of York, Pennsylvania, the entire school district being handed over to charters on the basis of test scores. So the more you have dropping, when you have dropping test scores, you have reasons, motivations for all kinds of actions. Why I say that people who independently review them basically say, look, when you have a test that costs less than $30 a student to administer, it's not going to test higher order thinking. It's not going to have a lot of writing on it. It's not going to have a lot of kids writing out equations. It's not going to be graded by a credentialed expert. You can't buy that for that kind of money. And so without massively changing the format of the test or some huge leap forward in technology that isn't there yet, you can't test higher order thinking with a test that costs that much.
Okay. Maurice, would love to hear your thoughts about the book and also your kind of broader perspective on standardized testing as an expert on early education, among other things.
Sure. I mean, I think that I read the book. It's a great book. It does bring up, you know, I was recently asked to sit on a panel, and the young lady who called me said that we would like you to sit on this panel because you've been in the early childhood space for quite some time. And I said to her, you mean I'm old, right? And so I've been in this space for quite some time, this psychometric space. And, you know, even the chronology when you write in the book, I mean, this really, for those who've been around for a while, Jerry, this really started with Sputnik. You know, it really did start with Sputnik, and we were not first in space. And so this has been an historical, then we went to minimal competency, and we had the Texarkana scandal because the teachers cheated. This is in the 70s. And so we're always trying to get better. And I guess I'm wondering, and I have lived in the early childhood space, but I was deputy superintendent for the DC public schools before. So I know this pre-K to 12 arena. But what is it we're trying to do? What do you think? I mean, what in the hell are we trying to do?
I mean, what do you think?
I mean, what is the purpose of all this? I mean,
right.
I read about children getting tummy aches and crying and everything.
Yeah.
But if you've taught children, they always have tummy aches and crying. You know? They don't want to go outside. They don't want to do the math lesson. So that was not.
Well, here's one theory. Mm-hmm. Is that what we're trying to do with education reform is to square a circle. We want to eradicate poverty without paying for it. And so somehow if we invest in education enough to increase opportunity, I mean, you know, if you read the book, No Excuses, right? Heritage Foundation, 2001, right?
I know them.
Yeah. So, I mean, I called that guy up and I said, okay, you wrote this book that said there's seven high-performing schools in these in high-poverty areas that are succeeding, and if every school does what these schools do, every school with high-poverty students will succeed. The outlier will become the norm. Mm. And that is a statistical imaginary idea. The outlier doesn't become the norm because the outlier and the norm are not the same. So, you know, the whole no excuses movement from then until now has been based on data. You know, they're taking data as their basis
right.
for how they're making decisions, how they're kind of moving toward, but they're not necessarily, I haven't seen yet a compelling explanation for how that actually happens.
So, you know, in terms of, so some of this comes out of our vision of the child, you know, how we see children and
yeah.
their development.
Yeah.
And so there is an assumption in this obsession,
yeah.
Which I'm telling you, this obsession, one of the reasons I don't worry about this kind of stuff, because the pendulum swings back and forth. Mm-hmm. When the test scores go down on the park and the other, there we're going to find, you know, we were going to be the, in 2000, we were going to be the best in the world, you know,
yeah.
just like Lake Wobegon. And then we were to leave no child behind. And every time we leverage it around high-stake testing, mm-hmm. it fails. And one of my big concerns, well, there's two dimensions. So one, I mean, what do you think the vision of children is based on this obsession with testing? What do you think people, psychometric, you know, the government and policy, what do they think? What do they know about children, first of all?
Well, I mean, one surprising reality that I learned mm-hmm. was that assessment as a discipline doesn't live in the same realms as cognitive psychology, developmental psychology, or learning sciences. They're not, they can tell you what you know and what you don't know based on their construct of the test
right.
and what they built. They can't tell you how to learn mm-hmm. what you don't know, or indeed how likely you are to be able to learn what you don't know.
Right. No, you're absolutely right. And so if we believe that all children can learn and develop at the same level, and that there are periods in their development when we can check in and they are just wonderful, you know, to me suggests that we don't understand child development. We don't understand human growth and development. And our vision of children is that we can assess them and move in sort of like an assembly line mentality in terms of looking at children's growth. So one of the things I would offer, you know, is to consider multiple ways of measuring intelligence. I mean, a la Howard Gardner or any of the people who are doing neuroscientists. And then the other theme that didn't come through in here, which was not your purpose in writing the book, but it's something that is of great concern to me, and that is the achievement gap. You know, that when you create high-stake testing and you do not make allowances for children from under-resourced communities? I mean, the assumption about testing is that everyone has the same thing.
I mean, I do feel like I talk about the achievement gap, and what I kind of came to understand about the achievement gap in the book was that I call it a tautology,
right,
masquerading as a problem. Mm-hmm. You know, when a study shows that 85% of the variation in test scores of a group of students in North Carolina, 85% is predicted by their family income. Why do you even need to give the test if it is so closely correlated? And a test like the SAT is also extremely closely correlated with family background and income. Why do you even need to give an achievement test to define what's happening to these children? We already know what the issue
right.
is. And once you level, if you manage to level that resource issue and you're still dealing with natural variations mm-hmm. and inclination and interest, and that is the job of the educator. Mm-hmm. But I would argue that the achievement gap is a job that's being left at the door of the educators.
So what would you think about a national movement to eradicate the achievement gap?
I think as long as we call it the achievement gap, it's not necessarily going to help.
We can call it the opportunity gap. Well, there's a gap that is real and persistent.
A different
right.
way of, I mean, to kind of get back to your question about what are people thinking? You mm-hmm. know, why is this happening? I mean, there's a line that I think is actually it's a really good line in the book, but can be taken a couple of different ways where you talk about, and I'm not going to quote it from memory as well, so it's really good, but something to the extent that as things become more and more standardized, and they are becoming more standardized, we're going from 50 different, you know, we're going from thousands of standards to 50 standards to two or three sets of standards now. That's been
right.
the course of the last 30 years.
Right.
And thus the tests are standardizing along with them. And you say, inevitably, this has the effect of eradicating difference.
Right.
I think that's the line.
Yeah.
But I think that the policymaker's mindset is that it's to eradicate the difference of ignorance. That in other words, that you have vast differences in outcomes among lots and lots of people, and that those outcomes are mostly a function of a combination of pervasive societal inequality that manifests both in what happens to students in school, but also to what out of school, but also to what happens to them in school. That you can, and you talk about this, resource disparities,
sure.
Teacher disparities, lots of disparities. And so that the foundation for some kind of pro-education equality agenda is knowledge of the nature of the inequality, and that should be expressed in terms of learning. And so you find the best measurements available to understand that inequality, and then you move from there. So putting the limitations of the measurements aside for a second, because your book actually, in the second half, I read as quite optimistic about
yeah.
how we can know more.
Right.
Is that an invalid sort of public policy theory to sort of start with the information and then create policy around it?
Well, I mean, it depends what political what your political background is and what you're most afraid of, right? Are you most afraid of government intervention to schools? Mm-hmm. Or are you most afraid of what schools will do or localities will do when left totally on their own?
Is there a distinction between government and schools instead of public schools?
I think that the debate around the Common Core that's playing out suggests that families perceive a very big difference between the jurisdiction of their local public schools over their child and the federal government's jurisdiction over their child's education. Whether that's correct or not, this is a very locally controlled and diverse school system, right? In terms of standardization, I mean, to my mind, the standards are not that meaningful without the tests and the accountability framework that underlies them. You know, the standards could be stand on their own and be taken or left without the necessity that schools test to the standards and punish for failing the standards. And to the extent that we're going to hold schools accountable to these specific learnings, these specific types of learning and you know, not a curriculum, but a set of types of learning, we better be pretty sure that is exactly and only what students need to know. And I haven't seen the data that would suggest that. We didn't validate the Common Core, right? We didn't test the Common Core before it was rolled out. We didn't pilot it. And this has been pointed out by many, many critics. So whether I believe in theory in a unitary set of standards is kind of secondary to the actual standards that we have.
And so the book is kind of doesn't feature a lot of robust defenders of standardized testing, not because I don't think you were looking for them, because in the contemporary dialogue, I don't think they're easy to find.
I actually got a chance to talk to Sandy Kress after the book ended, unfortunately. He said that he would take it to meet his maker, the slight increase in achievement and the slight narrowing in the achievement gap, especially for African Americans, which has been seen over the last 12 years. So that should be on the record.
No, I think that's certainly, when you come to the end of that line, I think you'll find Sandy standing there.
Yeah.
You know, so, but it, you know, at the same time, and you talk about how in different districts there are like a lot of examples of parents starting to opt out, and it's probably worth spending a little time on the opt out movements
sure.
at some point. But nonetheless, like day to day, every state in America and every major district, and the national government. Is sort of objectively pro-standardized testing. They're all doing it. There's no,
right.
You can't find a district of any size that says, no, we don't want to do it. So why is that, do you think? I mean, is it mass delusion? Is it lack of something better? Like, what is going on?
How many people in this room remember what they got in their SATs? Okay, and has that information been useful to you, other than the guy who teaches it?
Still, my scores are not useful in the job.
So, numbers are super powerful. Numbers that say something about our own ability are unbelievably powerful. And to the extent that we want, every parent wants that information about their kid, and every parent wants that information about their kid's school. Every parent wants that information about their kid's teacher. Every school wants that information about their kids and about their and on down the line. Our thirst for metrics and data is not, and that's one of the reasons, like the arguments in this book don't satisfy some of the most extreme opt-outers who want to get rid of everything except for teacher-created assessments, because I acknowledge the point that we've gotten to this place because everybody wants data and information. And the only question I'm asking is, you know, your metrics are only as good as your underlying data, and your analytics are only as good as your underlying data, so let's really peel back the curtain and see what we really have here. Not to deny the power of that, because I think it's very powerful.
But, you know, part of sort of the historical journey we've been on is the resistance to a national curriculum and a national assessment.
Sure.
But the truth of the matter is, that's where we are, not even where we're going. And I think that, so there is a body that wants that. And again, I go back to, it's a body who does not understand human development. And so I just wonder if in your research and in thinking about this book, and of course people who opt out, and you know, opting out is an issue, but people leave when they don't feel that they're getting what they want, because the truth of the matter is, in some instances, in some communities, opting out for children from under-resourced communities has made a difference for them, and their parents for the first time believe they have a choice. But I just wonder if there is any talk, as you talk, you know, interacted with people, about that people are just saying that we have to have a different way of looking at this.
Absolutely, there is. I mean, I see leaders all across the country, from Joshua Starr in Montgomery County to the core group of school districts in California, various charter school network leaders, the Performance Standards Consortium, all across New England,
right.
in New York as well. Julian Vasquez-Heilig and Linda Darling-Hammond, their multiple measures, community accountability approaches, the idea of bringing in, I mean, at its very baseline, let's remove the single point,
right.
the thread from which we hang all accountability, and add other measures into our accountability determinations and not make any decisions based on one test. That fundamental idea, I feel like, is gaining a lot of traction. Mm-hmm.
So there are multiple forms of assessment, and there's not just one.
Multiple forms of assessment, multiple approaches to assessment, multiple factors other than just assessments in accountability. So all of these things. And I think, you know, the opening up of public pre-K and the enfolding of pre-K into the public school system, I think, is a really interesting opportunity for this, because I mean, on one hand, people say, oh, we're going to have kindergarten assessments, and we're going to have four-year-old assessments, and the standardized tests will reach into the cradle. But there's also a side of, well, if you want to do accountability for a pre-K, everybody knows that pre-K students have social and emotional needs, and a good pre-K teacher is one who addresses those needs. It doesn't matter if all the kids know their letters, if they're you know, hitting and biting each other and peeing on the ground, right? So how do we assess schools, right? But I mean, you know, so how do we assess schools and hold them accountable within a public framework without just testing the kids, because clearly that's not enough in pre-K.
But the wave has, we now states have kindergarten entrance assessments.
Right.
That, you know, and so there's also pre-K assessments. And so that this pushing down and this obsession, your
right.
words, this obsession with testing, because people don't know about 3 and 4 year olds, and one day they know something, the next day they don't know something. But
right.
so it's like you can't really assess young children with right. any reliability. But this is, I mean, the big concern in the field is the pushing down of the, well, there's a curriculum, but there's also this testing.
Right.
That, and I don't see this ground, I mean, people complain, but I want action. I want
yep.
people to do something about it.
I understand that, definitely.
So the second part of your book,
yeah.
the first part of the book is, again, this very comprehensive critique of standardized testing as we know it now, and how it's used. The second part of your book goes into a lot of detail, and this is, I think, this was kind of the biggest learning experience for me, probably because I've kind of like lived in the first half of those debates like for a while,
yeah.
About a lot of possibilities for how assessment, I won't even use the word testing because I think that's too narrow, but how assessment measurement could be better. And you
yeah.
you talk about robots, monkeys, butterflies, and unicorns.
Yeah.
So tell us what you mean.
Right. So So in order for assessments to get better, first of all, people have to be motivated for them to get better. And at various points along, for example, in the big test, Nick Lehman's great book, in his great book about the history of the SAT, you know, they experimented with all kinds of different tests, including Myers-Briggs version, maybe even some Rorschach blots. But in the end, it was all abandoned because it was too expensive. So the question is, how could we have these kind of better tests? Knowing that what we know now about what makes people successful. And the robot approach is, you know, what I called in my recent NPR post, self-assessment. And this basic idea is, you know, businesses used to shut down at the end of the year for 3 weeks just to take stock manually, right, with a price gun. And that is what schools do. They shut down for 8 partial testing days, right, at the end of term to take stock. What if we could do a just-in-time accounting of what students know on a daily basis? And what we'd also learn from that is not just the math and reading information, one score in one day, but we would learn a pattern of how students approach difficult problems, how they approach easy problems, do they give up easily, you know, are they diligent at trying stuff before they get it? So within the data, and this is when you get into really, you know, people that are interested in data are human people too, and they're interested in the human sides of data, more so than what a single score can tell you. So, I'm interested in that possibility. That's to bracket that out. That is a big business possibility. That's something that Pearson's really excited about. ETS is really excited about. So, if you're nervous about the potential of for-profit companies controlling assessment, you should be nervous about that too. But that is one thing. And I really do think it's different. I think it's different from a static math or reading score. I think it gets rid of test anxiety. I think it, potentially could, change how we think about, there's a lot of talk these days about growth measures, which is basically comparing the score on one test to the score on another test. But tiny summing up every single day can do that in a different way. The monkey guys, right, this is the idea of using low stakes data gathering in the form of surveys, which is what we have, to talk about social emotional and not just, I mean, social emotional skills is really the wrong way of talking about it. We can talk about social and emotional climate. So we can talk about the behavioral records in a school, the discipline numbers. We can talk about, for example, there's a really awesome study about teachers' reports of eighth graders' behavior problems predicted their high school graduation rates. Really robustly. So if you ask someone, seventh grade teacher or eighth grade teacher, if they get in fights, you know if they're going to graduate high school. So gathering that kind of information, summing it up with these surveys, which groups like Gallup are making available, and California, and there's a Healthy Kids survey, which is pretty big. And asking kids really simple questions like, I feel excited to come to school every day. I have a best friend at school. these data points when summed up. Again, you can't attach high stakes to that because you can't attach high stakes to a kid saying they're happy, right? Because the teacher stands over them and says, you are happy, write it down. But as an information gathering purpose and as a basis for decision making on a school level, this is promising. The butterfly people are the kind of core of people that say that each child is an individual, and testing and learning should be one and the same, that we should assess through authentic tasks that are performance-based, portfolio-based, presentation-based, research projects, group projects, assess the kind of skills that students really need in the workplace, have them, you know, be able to speak publicly and to talk about their work and to combine disciplines as we all do in our lives. A 12-year-old kid in Kentucky I talked to, you know, had done one of these. He said, let's get real. No one's going to be bubbling answers at their jobs. You know, in this school, I know that what I'm doing really matters. It's a beautiful idea. The schools that are organized this way seem like the ones that I visited seem like really great schools. The students seem really great. It is very hard to codify this stuff. Kentucky, in fact, included portfolios in their state accountability system 20 years ago. It was dropped. Principals and teachers complained that it was too difficult. The idea of imposing this on a national basis seems kind of tough, but it's still a really promising approach. Finally, unicorn. Unicorn, I say, because it may be mythical, and this is idea could we somehow combine a technologically approach that is very data intensive as that with an approach that has kids performing authentic tasks, like a performance-based approach. And so these game-based assessments, and I talked about Glass Lab, where basically the kid is playing the game presents them with opportunities to make decisions or to critique their own work or to model a system, and the game is sort of using you know, complicated analytics to make extrapolations and gather evidence about the kid's thinking process. And so what you get at the end is not like a score per se, but what you get is a profile of a kid that says this kid has a second order understanding of systems thinking and of using evidence to make an argument.
So I was intrigued with your unicorn people.
Yeah, right. They're fascinating.
Yeah, they are fascinating. And I was curious, have you seen that both and any place around, you know, as you did your research, were there places where people were pursuing that?
Well, yeah. I mean, that's the Glass Lab.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the AAA Lab. I mean, these are tiny, tiny, tiny right. experiments. Mm-hmm. Glass Lab is available. They're making another game available, which is teaching kids rhetoric and argument structure. Mm-hmm. But then there's also, I mean, within the broader realm of serious gaming, not so much thinking about assessments, but thinking about what does game play teach kids and what can we learn about kids from having them play games. I think, you know, that's that the interest in that area is only going to grow.
Right. I mean, they're using it in teacher preparation programs. And right. So, yeah. So.
Well, simulations mm-hmm, have, right. I mean, simulations have been around for a really mm-hmm, long time.
Right.
Right. And they are not speculative. They're mm-hmm, proven in right. terms of learning a thing by sure. practicing it in a mm-hmm. low-stakes way.
Right.
So at the near the end of your book, you have a pardon me, a little scene where your daughter, right. Lulu, who is how old now?
Lulu, she's three.
Three. And yeah. so in your neighborhood in Brooklyn,
yeah.
There's a for-profit chain of essentially drill and kill test prep for 3 and 4-year-olds.
Yeah.
So like as the...
Two-year-olds.
So as the parent of a 4-year-old, I was just terrified.
Yeah.
But that even existed and was revising my like aspirations to live the Brooklyn yuppie lifestyle.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be anywhere near stuff like that. But you know you kind of also acknowledge that even as a you know you or as a parent or anybody feels a kind of almost a visceral reaction to that. There's also a strong desire to know and both inherently and also because you understand that the number will matter sometime, you know, whether it's, and probably not until, probably before they turn 17 and have to take the SAT or whatever we use then. So, and so, what should the parents in the audience or watching online or whomever, like, how should they think about this? What should they do?
They should read the book.
First and foremost, read the book.
Last chapter of the book gives a step-by-step approach. Like, I take it as, here are things you can do if you want to change a testing landscape. Here's how to opt out if you decide to opt out. Most parents of children in public schools are not going to opt them out of every single test, especially the tests that have high stakes for that student, like to get them into a competitive middle school, to get them into a competitive high school, or a gifted kindergarten. Most parents I know, if they're committed to public school, are going to try to get their kids to do well in those tests. And so what I advocate, what sort of neatly, you know, I feel like the more you understand about how these tests work, A, the less afraid of them you are, and B, the better you're going to do with them. Because really, the limitation of standardized tests is that they all test the same thing. They all test your analytic skills, your ability to eliminate choices and make a guess and stay cool in different situations, your ability to think structurally about a test. Where am I in this section? What kind of test is this? Does this test have one-third easy questions, one-third medium, and one-third hard? Or does it have 50% hard and 25% medium, 25% easy? That's going to make a difference on what I guess on that, on this particular problem. So the limitation of these tests is also their strength. If you are a guy like Bob Alexander, the testing wizard in Florida, who can get NCAA, you know, people to meet their NCAA requirements even if they never passed a class, because he teaches them how to think strategically about how the tests work. And I think, you know, I don't see any harm in that as long as you are simultaneously working in other ways potentially to, you know, if you want to help whatever it is that you believe is right, the right thing to do. I think that having more kids understand how tests work, particularly kids who have other disadvantages, as long as the system is there to be gamed, we might as well game it in people's favor.
And so think a little bit about kind of how these two sets of issues, how we use tests and what the best tests can be, might converge in the future.
So what fascinates me about this conversation is that I do see that for people who are open-minded, that science is leading them back, gently back toward a more holistic concept of what a human being is and what human development is. And what I mean by that is, you know, if you take like Paul Tough's book, right? Paul Tough's book is about the most hardcore data-driven people who thought only test scores mattered, looked at the long-term data, which was outcomes for their kids, and found it's not only test scores that matter. There's something else that's missing here, and we don't know what that is. Now, if you rush in to slap another test on that, maybe you're really missing the point. But the idea that science can lead us back toward a consideration that, you know, 0 to 3 is really, really important, and that means that, oh, parents are really, really important. We must be working with parents and making home visits and figuring out what that is supposed to be. Brain science tells us that we need to feed kids. So, like, the more if you really look at what science is telling us and don't rely on old science, I think you can get a better vision, a better test, and also, I mean, a better outcomes potentially.
So, I mean, do you think that will embolden the next generation Sandy Crest to say, well, okay, now the numbers are good enough, and so full speed ahead with trying to implement some kind of robust policies where this stream of information is acted upon governmentally, administratively, et cetera, you know, teacher evaluations, you name it.
Well, modern science is not positivistic, and good scientists keep an open mind to the possibility that they might be wrong about things. And I mean, in the first chapter, I lay out the issue with what we have now that we call a data-driven system, which is that when you attach an outcome to a measure, it's no longer a good measure. So I think part of the solution may lie in separating out the testing and the consequences, or at least combining them in a different way. I'm not sure exactly what that's going to be, but there's a clear structural problem with tying tests to consequences in the way that we're doing it now.
But don't you also, I was interested in your pursuing sort of the non-cognitive, and so there is this growing body of consideration of non-cognitive and, you know, grit, tenacity, and perseverance, and in Paul's book as well. And so, I mean, I'm almost thinking that that is going to be the fallback position for people once the testing doesn't. And all, you know, I think that people are going to raise this, and I welcome it.
Right.
But I think people are going to raise that as, well, that really wasn't important. Because, again, historically, every time we've gotten ourselves in a jam, we've moved on to something else. And
right. I mean, and the other thing I just want to mention is that you also have to think about schools as ecosystems, and teachers are very, very important in this conversation, and teachers' objections to standardized testing, I think, are really important to listen to, because the fundamental objection that I hear is that a professional is not a person who has an external, that is that is substantially committed to an external review on their performance. A professional is a person who is open to feedback from their peers, from their supervisors, and from the people that they serve. But there isn't an external person coming in to tell me whether or not I'm a good NPR journalist based on a standardized instrument. And so teachers who say that they feel demoralized or say that their morale is really low, because fundamentally they've been removed from the process of deciding whether or not they're doing a good job.
Right.
And that doesn't make for a great environment for kids, because, you know, if somebody's autonomy has been removed, how are they going to teach a kid about autonomy, or how are they going to teach a kid about anything that they need to know?
Or how are they going to be pleasant when they teach?
Thinking a little more about the policy dimensions a bit about this, there's a section in the book around this idea of holding states and districts accountable for resources. And you talk, you relate a conversation you had with a weary policy think tank person at a Gates Foundation funded cocktail party. I think that was me. Am I wrong about that? Yes. So, for the record, I was mostly weary because my flight had been canceled, and I just had to get off the phone with my wife saying, I'm not going to be home for 48 hours, so you have to take care of our three-year-old for two more days. So, it's a point taken, and I think, you know, one of the kind of meta critiques of the testing regime and the idea of holding mostly schools. We don't even really hold districts accountable for test scores. We mostly hold, because they're there, you can't really move them. But we mostly hold schools accountable. Is that,
except in the case of New Orleans,
special circumstances? Yes. But yeah, I think that's right. Any rational concept of how the system works is a combination of inputs and processes, and that if you just ignore the inputs, that it's going to break, because you're essentially holding people accountable for things that they're not responsible for. And, you know, even, I mean, some of the maybe more extreme critiques, which I don't really share, but I understand them, is that this is actually a way to ignore the resource issue. But I think, you know, the flip side is, and I think this was my response at the time, was, you know, you're really talking about, like, the nature of American government, federalism.
Yes.
And so we have education as this core element of our society and our obligations to our citizens and our students that is more so than anything of similar size decentralized and defederalized and always has been. And so the testing agenda has been in lockstep with an agenda toward more federalization and centralization of education, and most of those steps have been about equity, right? In the middle of the 20th century, the federal government's abiding concern around education was providing racial justice, and very much renegotiating the power relationships between itself and the states, and there was all kinds of resistance to that. And so I think a protesting person might say, look, we need evidence to sort of show how bad things are if we're going to mount a political case for the kind of resource equity that doesn't exist right now.
Somebody could certainly say that. I think it's also the case that after, in the wake of 13 years of hardcore accountability, test-based accountability, our schools are more segregated. And that it's also the case that charter schools, which are the concept of school choice is centered around this idea of we're going to test all the kids, report out the test scores, and then parents will have a basis on which to make a more informed decision about their children's education. The charter school movement is also, charter schools are also more concentrated racially, and they're also more concentrated in terms of poverty. So if tests go in lockstep with an equity agenda, I guess the question that I would ask is, what are they doing for that equity agenda? Are they improving it?
So I think there, it's probably, there's a bunch of different ways to answer that, I think. You can interpret the national education data in different ways. I mean, the achievement gap has not been closing over the last 15 years, but it has not been closing in an environment of overall slight but real improvement, right? So it's not been closing not because privileged people are doing better and non-privileged people are doing worse. They're actually both doing better, but the distance between them is not shrinking. Mm-hmm. You can think about that in different ways. I mean, mm-hmm. It's not surprising, and that happened during a time when overall American equality got substantially worse, right? So it wasn't as if the underlying equality trends were kept constant,
right.
And then we really focused on closing the educational part of it. They were getting worse. And I mean, I think anyone would recognize that those two things are interrelated.
I mean, the purpose of Brown versus Board of Board of Education wasn't to close something called the achievement gap, it was to desegregate schools. And so, right?
Separate but equal.
I mean, but separate but equal was seen as profoundly unfair from an educational standpoint, right? So
yes, it was. Well, I mean, so, but I'm saying if the point of that equity movement was to desegregate schools, not just because it's nice to have schools that are racially balanced, but because it's an unequal educational environment if they're not. The point that I'm making is, if we don't desegregate schools, if we actually are resegregating schools, then how are we achieving an equity agenda, even if everybody's doing a little bit better?
I mean, we haven't resegregated schools. Schools have become resegregated because the legal environment and political environment doesn't really, there are limitations to how it permits us to move
where
students
live,
around.
Where you go to school.
So, you know, again, I think it's kind of...
Well, and why are people more segregated in their neighborhoods?
You don't know. Let's start with redlining. And, no, I mean...
Sure. Yeah, no, that's, well, I mean, I'll give one potential explanation. One potential explanation is that there is a polarization of real estate values. There's a real estate intensification, right? Really high really high real estate prices. Part of that driven, according to Elizabeth Warren in her book, The Two Income Trap, which came out way before the mortgage crisis, families looking for houses in good school districts. Huge, huge differences.
Sure.
Between high test score areas and lower test score areas.
Social justice issues. So the bulk of the middle class, in my opinion, was developed with the GI Bill because people could go to school and they could buy property.
Yeah.
There was a practice of redlining, which meant you could only buy in certain areas if you were a person of color.
Right.
Real estate increases, and that's how you build wealth. And so if I force you to live in a low-valued real estate environment, you're never going to build the wealth to move up. You will. So, I mean, that is really the history of why people are in the neighborhoods they're in. And now, I mean, it's off the chart.
And I mean, these are complicated questions. I mean, so like a month or so ago, I was interviewing Josh Starr, who you mentioned from Montgomery County, who's been a very, a national testing critic, but also not an absolutist by any means. I mean, I put it right to him. I said, if you were in charge, how many tests would there be? And his answer was fewer, but not none. You know, there would still be benchmarks at different points. I mean, he was an accountability person. But the other thing we ended up talking about, and we will get back to testing in a moment, but I think this is interesting. Montgomery County is an extraordinarily diverse school district, one of the most sort of unusual school districts in America in a lot of ways, and becoming more divided, mostly because of the underlying economic and demographic trends. And I said, they don't really have a school choice environment in Montgomery County, and I asked him, should there be one? And he said, look, some people absolutely want the ability to send their kids to different parts of the county. Some people really just want good schools in the communities they have and aren't really interested in that. And that's, that's been kind of the push and pull of desegregation and a lot of these things. But we are here to talk about tests.
Yeah.
So a couple of things. I want to give you one more chance to talk about anything in the book that we haven't had a chance to talk about. Yes, we'll then go to questions from the audience. We also have people watching online. Because this is 2015, just tweet at Anya directly.
Yep, that's why I have my phone here.
And cut me and the whole middleman out, and you can just talk to her, and she'll talk back to you.
I just want to hear from the Q&A. I want to hear what people have to say.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's go right to questions from the audience. Down in front.
Hi, my name's Dave Price, 30 years in poor urban areas as a teacher, 4 as a consultant based in D.C. going around. Observation, I'll get to my question as quickly as I can, Anna. Not only is your book valuable, it's brilliant. And the reason I say that, it agrees with everything I think. So that's what I did. And I have that on 99.974631%. So we have it there. Then I just want to speak for a second as a grandfather, make the matter more real. You have Lulu, we have Audrey. Audrey entered first grade this year in Dunwoody, a very wealthy section of Atlanta. and in her first 2.5 weeks had 4 days of standardized testing.
Wow.
That's America today. Now my question is this, and you've really done excellently. There's one place that I have a concern, and again, personalize it. My college roommate was high ranking in McGraw-Hill, but that wasn't good enough. He moved to Pearson. And I think he may be the Antichrist, I'm not sure, but that's something else. The point is, there's so much money involved in this,
right?
Okay? As you did your research, as you go around, and again, not just to preface this, I know because I follow his career.
Yeah.
We give the test, the kids don't do well, so we give the prep. But we don't give the prep real well because we realize there's not enough time. So then we design the school books, and so we really have total control. One side, Bill Gates, the other. We're going to make the tests on computers. Great, Bill. Who makes the computers? So how much do you think, and A, if it is involved, what can we do about that? The other things we can do. Thank you.
Sure, thank you so much. This is America, and capitalism is very important.
Did you say we should be communists?
No. I guess what I'm trying to say is, I mean, I looked at that angle, and I looked at the business of testing, and there's a lot to be said about the business of testing, the profitability of testing, and as you mentioned, many public statements make clear from Bill Gates, Arne Duncan, and others, that the Common Core, from a certain set of stakeholders' point of view, represents the consolidation of a marketplace of tests, materials, assessments, and machines to put them on. That's just how they look at it, because they're, when you have a platform, these things are interoperable and therefore sell to one, sell to all. This is a business opportunity. I think you have to remember, Pearson's the largest English language publisher, but publishing is not a great business to be in. And so as much as they are the 500-pound gorilla in terms of education, they're not such a scary, enormous, or thriving company even from the point of view of American corporations. The involvement of the technology industry in education is a different story, because it's a much larger and more powerful sector. And these interests are important. A case to watch is the one of the iPads in Los Angeles and the FBI investigation around that, because it appears that the deal is an iPad deal, it seems to be that it's Pearson that's under investigation, hasn't yet been announced exactly what the purpose of the investigation is, but KPCC released these emails between Pearson and the office of the DOE, LAUSD, talking about the contract and we have to make sure to get you guys in and get this bid in, and that kind of stuff. So, there's definitely a major consumer watchdog role to take. But to me, I guess my bias is that the politics comes first.
Yes, ma'am, in the back. And I'll let you decide when to take Twitter questions.
Yeah, I'm just seeing what's a comment and what's a question.
My name's Roberta Stanley, and I work for the state of Michigan Department of Education for a number of years and on the Hill. My observation is that the governor's being more involved in education after they solved welfare reform in 1994. They were looking for simplistic ways, and the businesses could access governors more readily than state departments of ed because of the bidding process. Would you comment on the governor's involvement and their tendency for reformitis and wanting quick fixes?
I can't comment too specifically about that, but I guess I make the observation in the book that test scores are different from other kinds of data, let's say jobs numbers or environmental numbers, because they are so much more open to adjustment. And if you look at the way that, for example, Mayor Bloomberg in New York City ran on test scores that were then readjusted and fell precipitously between one term and the next, there's not many other numbers that you can do that with. And so you do see that test scores are the type of numbers that are tend to be embraced by political leaders, either as a banner of what's working or as a banner of what's not working.
In the back.
Thanks. Just following on from that, something that I'm aware of is the use of tests that may intentionally kind of target a collection of schools. So when we think about, what is the use of tests, what is the functional use of tests, the political use of tests is obviously very important. So thinking about, why is it so difficult to achieve you know, better controls on tests? You know, why aren't we looking at income as much? And then you say, well, who's advantaging from the current kind of focus on scores bereft of those kinds of controls? I mean, isn't that important?
Could you rephrase the question?
Okay. If a primary use of the tests is political change, possibly increased charter schools, privatization, some of these things where you know that there are, you know, private parties that are benefiting, you know, is that something we should be focusing on more as a problem? Because, you know, if we're not really looking at whether tests support educational change within schools, but really mostly support a change of administration to a private entity, you know, what does that mean?
I mean, I guess what I can say about that is where you see parents organizing and educators organizing against standardized tests, they definitely see it as part of a broader agenda, which is an anti-privatization, anti what they call market-based reform, in pro-local control and pro-increased resources for schools, and often pro-teachers union, anti-charter schools. So definitely people see these issues as all being connected, and it's not just about tests.
Sure.
My name is Andrew Dufresne, and I'm a professional tutor with Prep Matters, as I indicated before, academically and for tests. My background is in science, but first I want to say thank you for mentioning, like, if you follow the science, then you actually get to perhaps more worthy reasons for your actions. My first point is on the tests in general. I think we can agree that the purpose of the test is twofold: to both reliably indicate a measurement of the student performance, and then also, hopefully, to accurately measure that performance and predict their future outcome. Now, reliability, I think we all agree also that the SAT and ETS do that very, very well, even if it's a bit forced with their use of the curve and how they shift the test. We're now coming up on the next of many changes in the SAT, whereas the ACT kind of just hung out. Mm-hmm. But then the accuracy of the test, I think you were mentioning how testing tricks and test prep and everything, I think that's a valid point to say, are we really actually, aren't we calling into question by the very nature of there are tricks to the psychology of testing that we can teach students, aren't we calling into question the validity of the test and its ability to do something accurately? So any comments on that about how we can actually address the question, is this even the way we should be going about doing this? Mm-hmm. And then my second point, if you had time, I also appreciated Mr. Carey's comment regarding using the test data as grounds for political argument and policy reform. Mm-hmm. I think there we may want to look beyond just the test itself and ask, why are we testing? What's the point of education? Is it in the end basically trying to get a population to be economically prosperous and beyond that happy? Some nations in the world actually go by a happiness index rather than a GDP. And if that's the case, should we not be tying our education and therefore our testing and benchmarks mm-hmm. to the shifting economy that we now see beyond just the technology use mm-hmm. for testing tools, but the fact that why is CS computer science not a major component of every education at this point?
Right. Yeah. No, those are really interesting points. I mean, I think when it comes to college admissions testing, on the one hand, you have about 800 colleges opting out of using standardized tests. Nice, for admissions, which is a really interesting phenomenon because the report is that most elite colleges rely on that almost exclusively as a first pass way of eliminating people. And the questions about the fairness are just as you say. Your question also gives me a chance to mention the research of Robert Sternberg, which I was really fascinated to learn about. And he's had a series of projects over the years. The Rainbow Project was funded by the College Board, and his idea was, he sort of segments intelligence into analytic intelligence, practical intelligence, and creative intelligence. He later added a fourth leg on the stool, which was wisdom. And that's sort of an integration of kind of empathy and long-term thinking. A really beautiful side of theory of intelligence. What's really interesting about it is he created instruments to test each of these components. He managed to use these instruments on very large numbers of students first in the Rainbow program, and then at Tufts University in the admissions office, where he was able to almost eliminate ethnic group differences in consideration because of the tendency of different ethnic groups to have different strengths distributed among those three areas. And the practical and creative intelligence items that he created, he first tried to create a machine scorable version of the test, and he said, no matter what you do in a machine scorable test, you're only testing analytic intelligence. But we had later versions of the test which required sort of a structured rubric grading process where in the creative one, an item would be like, come up with a caption for this cartoon. A practical intelligence one would be, you know, you're having a problem with a classmate, what do you say to your teacher? You know, solve a real world problem using real world, you know, skills. You know, these instruments have been in use in various places. He's now developing a grad student admission instrument. With the right resources, and even ETS is working on instruments that consider more factors and therefore give you perhaps a broader picture of what's gonna make someone successful.
Hi, I haven't read your book yet. I'm sorry, I'm Louanne McNabb with the National Council of Teachers of English, but do you address the impact on the arts and athletics and how they have been reduced in so many schools because of the standardized testing?
I do, yeah. I talk a lot about this in the curriculum, and a later report that I was able to do for NPR talked about specifically in high schools where the graduation test requirements have been implemented, which has been done in more than half of the states. Because with those graduation, it's really important for the kids to get a diploma. So what they end up doing is there's so many retakes of the tests, they just get administered again and again and again. And in some districts, it's like 40% of a specific month of the year. And when some kids are redoing the retakes, other kids have to just watch movies because the kids that already passed the test, if they keep studying math, they're going to be way too far ahead of the kids that haven't passed the test. I talked to some people in Florida, people in Las Vegas who said it's really, our school doesn't run. It doesn't run in April, it doesn't run in February, whatever the months are where they're giving these high school exit exams.
You do mention some of the European countries to whom we're compared unfavorably from a testing mania standpoint.
Yeah.
Do have an enormously high stakes end of school test.
Yeah.
And I wasn't quite sure reading it whether you thought that that would be something to go toward or run away from or?
Well, my colleague Corey Turner talked about this in the great NPR piece last fall where, yeah, like just one test with really high stakes, is that really a better mm-hmm. system? But I think, you know, it's part of a totally different philosophy, and that's what we have to like look at it as, because these tests aren't being used to punish schools or teachers. They are definitely very high stakes, and obviously in many of these countries in Europe, they're much more comfortable with a tracking approach to deciding children's futures based on, you know, a few weeks. But, you know, on the Asian system, there are definitely dissenters talking about the stress that these tests cause and how they're really trying to ration out a scarce commodity of university education, and is that really the best way to do it? What I'm intrigued by in the UK in particular is they just don't see the point of giving cheap multiple choice tests in any way, because they think that if you give high quality end of course tests, the teachers have to teach for long-term retention and they have to teach deep understanding of a subject, because you're going to have to demonstrate it after 9 months of study with one kind of summative assessment. And so from a pedagogical standpoint, it doesn't seem to me to be a terrible theory. And then the other part of the picture of accountability in UK schools is school inspections, which I find really fascinating as a tool and simple. I mean, the idea at least is simple, right?
I always have this sense of the, like, Mary Poppins shows up at your school.
Yes, very exactly.
Stern, you know,
white glove.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Sorry, questions? Yes, ma'am, right there.
Hi, I'm Sarah Wonder. I work at character.org. You mentioned how many teachers are becoming demoralized, and I'm curious what advice you have for teachers who see no end in sight with standardized testing and can't really opt out without maybe leaving the profession.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. My hat is off to you. It's a very difficult job. I see teachers who do manage to be creative and work around the requirements just as people do in all kinds of constrained situations. And then you see teachers like those in Chicago and those in Seattle who decide that this is a
a workplace issue and a union issue, and that they should refuse to administer the tests. So there's a range of responses.
Tom.
Thanks, Kevin. My name is Tom Tock. I'm with the Carnegie Foundation. Kevin has pushed gently, I think, a couple of times against your seeming concern about accountability. I don't want to say opposition, but maybe it is. But it's also the case, as Kevin has implied, that in many public schools, black and brown students are treated differently. The expectations that educators have for them are lower. They indeed have fewer resources and the like. But the notion behind accountability, test-based or otherwise, and I think many people would agree with your assessment of the limitations of standardized testing. Many people have, you know, there have been a number of sort of analyses of that sort. But that notwithstanding, the notion of accountability is designed to try, as Kevin suggested, to provide equity for students who, for whom expectations are too low, who are not being treated properly by the system. So what is your sense of or what is your view of accountability?
I too believe that equity is a good thing, and that students should not be treated differently based on the circumstances of their birth. I think, you know, the assumption, a basic assumption of good intentions on behalf of anyone engaged in this debate is that that is the baseline that we're coming with. And the question is, what policies best carry out that principle? I think for a long, the history of it to me describes a very interesting turn. Because what I see is that these tests were created by people as instruments of supremacy. That's how they were created. And they were created, founded on an ideology of supremacy. I mean, this it's there, and it carries from Galton in the 19th century all the way up through the bell curve. At some point, the instrument created by people as an instrument of supremacy became championed as an instrument of equity. And the idea that we would diagnose people, in the book, the No Excuses book, he says, diagnosis is not discrimination. And I find that to be a curious change.
So given the problems with standardized testing, assuming that analysis is accurate, how do we solve the problem?
Right. I'm gonna be the first one to tell you that that is bigger than the people in this room. That's a very big problem. It's not just an education problem. And I want our education system to be focused around it, but I don't think it's just gonna take our education system to solve it.
Sure, so one last thought on that. So how do we wanna make the perfect the enemy of the good, if you will? I mean, I think Kevin was implying this earlier too, that we all acknowledge, most people acknowledge the impact of poverty on student achievement for those kids of color in many instances, but also kids who are disadvantaged generally, right? What do we do? Do we wait until poverty is eradicated, or do we take steps in schools to address the achievement gaps?
I don't know that I agree with the term achievement gap. I see an opportunity.
Whatever.
Well, no, this is, I don't know that I agree with the disparity in performance. I agree with opportunity gap, because what I see is a difference that is described and predicted by the resources that a student has in their, and what they arrive with.
Which leads to the achievement gap.
Which leads to a gap in achievement, yes.
But some of those differences are manifested in the schools themselves.
Yes.
So it's not as if every school is the same,
yeah,
and then the resources vary and we get variable outcomes.
Well, every school is not the same. And I mean, I think, you know, I would argue from my experience spending time in certain schools that once the average income of a student, or let's say the percentage of free and reduced lunch
goes above a certain amount in that school, it's no longer an educational institution primarily, because the job of that school becomes to house, feed, and clothe students and connect them to social services and to do so many different things that have
to
be done.
Their job is to teach those children, regardless of their experience and back. Their job, I think that educators use that oftentimes
as something,
an excuse. The pedagogy of poverty, of lowballing what you give to children from certain contributes to the achievement gap. And a good urban school should look like a good suburban progressive school. And what we do is we dumb down the curriculum.
But do you think the standardized testing stops us from doing that?
Well, no, but you know, I've always taught in poverty schools. I mean, every school I taught in, over 75% of children were free and reduced lunch. But that's not the issue. The issue is to teach those children and teach them like you were teaching your own children, teach them like you teach middle class and upper middle class children. And that's what the problem is. It is this pedagogy of poverty. These are poor children. I don't have to do much. And I've been in too many teachers' rooms. You know, I know the conversation. Yeah. You're an outlier if you are progressive and acting on behalf of children.
Ma'am, in the back right there. Yes.
Hi, Melissa Finkel. I'm with the Maryland Department of Education. And a couple of things that you said tie into my question. You mentioned schools in England, you mentioned summative tests, and then I heard you start to talk about formative. Mm-hmm. And formative assessment is what we work on. So I was wondering if in your research, in your discussions with schools, they talked about assessment for learning or formative assessment as a way to drive student learning and not really focus on the summative at the end.
Say that again, I'm sorry.
I was just wondering if formative assessment or assessment for learning came up in your conversations with schools, and if you see that as a practice. We're hoping that it's a practice that's spreading more across the country, obviously in Maryland, but a number of other states that we work with as well, including Michigan. And I was just wondering if that's something that you saw at all, a discussion of self-assessment, really student empowerment, and feedback in the formative assessment process.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I feel like formative assessment is part and parcel of good teaching. That's what I learned, and that it's that good teachers have always seen assessment as an integral part to what they do, and part of the reason they object to standardized assessments is that it's taking away from the practice that they already have in their classroom of creating assessments and of helping students to develop their own assessments as well, their own process of self-assessment. I talk to educators lamenting the fact that they work on individualized assessment plans with students who may have, whether they have IEPs or whether they're gifted or whether they're mainstream, and they have individualized goals for them, which the standardized tests don't respect or don't include or ignore, and therefore there's a mismatch between what the school's being held accountable for and what the student and the family and the teacher are interested in having that student do and achieve.
Shayna.
Hi, my name's Shayna Cook. I'm a program associate here in the Early Childhood Initiative, and you all mentioned kindergarten entry assessments, and that's something that I'm interested in. NACE had released some guidance around it and said that it was supposed to be embedded in the actual curriculum. So it wasn't a kindergarten assessment in the traditional sense, but it was something that was going to be observed over time, seeing students how they performed in different authentic play situations. So something that's one of the solutions you provided. Some states have taken that, so that was a federal policy. It's come down to the local level, and I can give you an example. In Montgomery County, in the Washington Post recently, they described the assessment, and it was taking a student outside of the classroom for an hour, one-on-one. So the lead teacher is not in the classroom, and they're working with the student on this assessment in an inauthentic way for 1 hour. Mm-hmm. So the policy didn't trickle down
right.
The way that it was intended.
Right.
So happens often. So what I'm asking is, so some of your proposed solutions seem at this point, I know Maurice has had a long experience and has seen the pendulum shift, but
yeah.
Me as formerly young teacher and now working here, it's really hard to see in the foreseeable solution future these types of authentic assessment solutions. So if you could just describe some of, like, throw out maybe some of your vision of how that could be put into a policy format.
Sure. So, so low quality assessments got really popular for a really good reason, which is that they are machine scorable. They are industrial, mass produced. You can drop off packets at a school and then pick them up later, and the whole system is very kind of easy to use. And any other kind of test is probably going to be harder to implement and more expensive and take more resources and more training than the kind of test we're using now. On the other hand, when you talk to a performance assessment school that is doing things the way they've been doing them for 20 years, and you know they don't use Regents or high school standardized, state standardized tests, and I asked them, how much more money do you spend? And they said, we definitely spend less money because our this is part of our teacher's professional development. We don't spend money on outside tests, outside prep. The money is internal, and it goes towards training. It goes towards moderation studies where schools get together with each other and compare instruments of assessment, and all the infrastructure. And I think there's increasing attention these days. It sounds like to me there's increasing attention on the importance of teacher professional development and continuous development. And so if you look upon teachers as a resource in implementing and creating assessments, that's where you find the ability to adopt the kinds of tests that you want. It's more of an HR play than it is a technology play.
I just, you know, I want to move from antiquity to recent history.
Yeah.
The Congress, because it invested so much in Head Start, had a national reporting system where Head Start children were to be assessed. And given the lack of reliability of assessing young children, the whole program collapsed. They don't test. There's no longer a national reporting system for Head Start. So, I mean, that's recent. And because, again, back to development, kids are incredible. You know, young children are incredible. But, you know, even this kindergarten entrance, and certainly Maryland has been doing this. You know, Rolf is a good friend of mine and colleague. So they have been doing it in a reasonable way. And now they're in a consortium with Michigan and other places. But, I mean, there's a reasonableness to, we're not saying we shouldn't get information on children.
Right.
It is how we collect the information on children.
Well, and isn't it the case that in many places the accountability system for pre-K is also based around, I mean, robust indicators of high-quality pre-K include the education levels and the pay of the teachers.
Yeah, I don't want to go into my about over-promising and under-delivering. We are not clear about what those indicators, yes, but it is true. Commonly we say teacher preparation.
Hi, thanks. Congratulations on the book. I'm Beth Glenn with the Education Justice Network, and I wanted to circle back to the robot idea that you brought up and the idea of the civil rights concerns that Kevin raised. And I was wondering if you saw a system in reporting for the book that includes annual determinations of progress that would allow for the kind of disaggregated data for tracking civil rights concerns that Kevin raised. That puts that into play in a system without the punitives, high stakes testing that is going on now.
I mean, we don't yet have these applications in place. This is pretty theoretical at this point, but I mean, I don't see why not, I guess, would be my answer.
So the Kentucky example that you talked about with performance-based assessments, you know, feeding that into a system where you could give parents information about how their child's learning is going in a quote-unquote kind of real-time sense. Did that get developed when Kentucky did their experiment 20 years ago before it got dropped, or did they not get that far?
I don't know how portfolios really figured into the reporting, the accountability reporting. I know that it was part of the picture, but I don't know specifically, sorry. I do know that in the school, in the Bate Independent School District in Kentucky right now, where they tried this performance-based assessment experiment, they also used the ACT and the Compass test at the middle school level, and their intention was to track high school outcomes as well, to sort of create a bigger picture idea of how students were doing.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Ashley Parker. I'm with Hager Sharp, which is a communications firm. We work with a number of education clients. And so I have two parts to my question. The first is that, you know, when you're looking at assessments and your work for the book, like where does some of these low stakes, quote unquote, tests like NAEP, for example, National Assessment of Educational Progress, come into play? And also in your work with speaking with, you know, sort of folks from the opt-out movement, if you saw sort of, you know, talking about like parents and also students, like how their knowledge of the tests and what they are, if you saw sort of within those groups, if there was knowledge to discern the difference between tests like NAEP and then some of these high stakes annual tests, if there was sort of that understanding.
Survey data tells us, and interviews, my experience tells us that parents have no idea what their kids are taking or why or what it all means and which test is important for the student, which test is important for the school. I talked to the NWEA folks, and I was impressed with what they developed, and I see that when you remove stakes from a test, you have a chance to extract a lot more value in terms of student learning. However, where we see NWEA being put into place often as a benchmark test for states and districts and schools to improve their performance on the state tests, it's just one more test. And so from the kids' point of view, experience-wise, it's not a great experience to take that test.
Anyone on Twitter that you want to respond to?
It would be hard to, but someone says,
only in 140 characters.
Yes, I know, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, what is a school? What is a good school district? That's one question.
we'll end with an easy one.
Follow the money.
Yeah. Well, if we didn't measure good school districts by test scores, how would we measure them? And that is sort of the question that we're kind of in right now. And this is the question about equity. It's a question about my child. Do I stay in this part of Brooklyn or move to a different part of Brooklyn? What do we really need to know about our kids' schools, and how are we going to find that out? I think that's probably the next book.
Well, we will look forward to that book. Everyone, please join me in thanking Maurice and Anya for coming today.
Thank you very much.